sure when, so we will get an assessment of that. We've been working hard at our own self-assessment. I'm looking to Julia here because I think we're at a stage where, you know, there are some things that are working well. There are, and there's some definite areas where we need to work harder to get things right. And child sexual exploitation is a really good example of that. We've done an awful lot in this last year. We really mustn't be complacent about where we've got to, as much as we can put an awful lot in place and done a huge amount of work, because I still think there are children out there that we don't know about yet, that we get to come across and support. In terms of resources, I suppose to answer that, I would say first of all, I think we've got a strong partnership in terms of supporting children safe going. And the people and time that goes into this across the partnership is really strong. And that's our biggest resource. Because if we haven't got the minds and time that people can give, we can't do this work. But inevitably, there is less available financial resources. Work with perhaps some initiatives to the extent that we'd like to. So we'd like to be able to put more Chelsea's Choice out there, but the reality is that we took a big hit to be able to run that programme in all those schools. So we have to modify our approach this year. We've got the children's theatre, and that gives us a more affordable resource. And as people are saying, it has a good impact. So that's the way we have go, because they have to think about how else we can do things. But I believe we can find a way through with the support and partnership and the council.
Thank you.
Is it helpful, Chair, if I just make a brief comment? Something we've actually been doing today, we've had a development session with the Safeguarding Children's Board. So we brought together key members of the board with the self-assessment of using the Ofsted framework, how we think we're performing against that framework. And we brought people from the board together with people from children's services, early help and specialist services, who brought their own self-assessment to the meeting. So we've had opportunity to really work in groups to identify what we think we're doing well and where we think we've made improvements. I think it's fair to say there's absolutely no complacency. There's a recognition that there are key areas that we're on an improvement journey and continuously developing. One area, for example, is that you may have heard of is the multi-agency safeguarding model. And this is where a joint arrangement with police colleagues, with social care colleagues, with health colleagues coming together to be a first line where people can make referrals about children where there are concerns. And what we have at the moment is we've got police colleagues, we've got children's social care, we've got early help colleagues with a gateway, all sitting in Norbury at an office base, so they're actually physically co-located. But what we recognise we need to do is we need to kind of integrate those teams so that we've got a single front door. So that, for example, the teacher referring a child would refer to the single front door, and even if the teacher said, I think Johnny needs a social worker, the team at the front door would make that judgment based on the level of risk and vulnerability. And so they pull together health information, any information known about the family from the police, any historical information known about social care, and then form a view about where Johnny needed to go for him and his family to continue to get support. So at the moment we've got two different groups in with an early help gateway and a social care and a MASH aspect. So our development bit, our next step is to combine it all together. So and with all of this, it's how well you can tell the story in terms of your journey of improvement. Who the Ofsted inspectors see, how transparent the story is, and the people from the top tell one story and people at the front line tell the same story. So it's a constant flow of getting the communication right, being clear about the direction of travel, working with our partners constantly. Another area, perhaps to highlight, and it will come up in the performance information, it perhaps doesn't shine through, but I'll raise it, where a few months ago we were becoming concerned about the numbers of children we had in Wirral who were subject to a child protection plan. You become subject to a child protection plan if a certain threshold is met and the level of vulnerability and children have either experienced significant harm or there's a likelihood that they're experiencing significant harm. So being part of a plan is a signifier that there is a level of risk and vulnerability that needs very concerted and focused action to mitigate that risk. And when that risk is mitigated and reduced, children then, hopefully, if that's happened, can move off the child protection plan. If it doesn't reduce, then those children could end up becoming coming into care and being going through the court process of care proceedings. We were concerned that we thought our numbers of children subject to a child protection plan were seeming a bit low. And so what we did, a very concerted effort, was we reviewed children who were at a level below those with a child protection plan and who had what's called a child need plan. And we have identified, through reviewing those children who've had a child in need plan for 12 months or more, a number of children who were working well and the agencies were working on the plan, but who had met a threshold, who really did need the next level of intervention with the child protection plan. And so through that activity, our numbers of children with the child protection plan over the last 3 or 4 months have increased quite significantly. So that is an example of us again taking very proactive action. If Ofsted had come 4 months ago, they'd have said, why have we got such low numbers, possibly, or relatively low numbers? And we wouldn't be where we are now with our understanding of what services or how we need to escalate the vulnerability of those children and our response accordingly. So it's hard to give a precise picture of what judgment Ofsted have given us, but there are a couple of examples of how we're constantly working at how we improve. The other point in terms of resources, we're all feeling the squeeze, all of us, from every single agency. And the conversation this afternoon, in part, was about the community trust in Wirral, who were saying, we're looking at different ways of providing services and we want to bring that to the board. That wasn't in terms of reducing their budget, but we want to make sure that it's safe, the changes that we're looking at making. So you rely on the board understanding changes that each organisation is making, but particularly where there are reductions in funding, we need the board. And what we agreed this afternoon was the board will be every 2 months as opposed to every 3 months, so that we can make sure that we've got a really tight grip as organisations are going through the process of change. There have been some reductions in children's services, but would not reduce the number of frontline social workers that we've got. It's just a little bit of context.
Thanks, Julia. David, do you want to come in again?
Sorry, it was only just a naive point, probably. Chelsea's choice, which clearly, obviously, is extremely good. Is there any possibility of, given the nature and the emotive nature of the subject, whether there's outside funding from businesses to continued use? It can't be hugely expensive, I thought, to put on. And it's certainly something that if you were in a business locally, you'd want to be associated with. Just a thought.
It's a very good thought.
All right.
Just
to
add to that,
Treena and then Julia.
Oh, no, sorry, I was just another thought that perhaps that the government could give educational budgets in order to put them out in the schools.
Okay. families in Wellbeing dashboard, pages 15 to 38. My panel is going to come and talk about this.
Thank you, Chair. I'll just present the report and obviously then hand over to colleagues to answer any sort of specific questions in terms of the actual performance indicators and the targets in the appendix to the report. So on page 15 is the cover report, and this is the quarter one performance report for the Families and Wellbeing Director Plan. So that's performance from April to June. And this follows on from approval of that plan. McKinsey had cited that plan back in March, and so the June meeting was the year-end year-end performance, 14-15, obviously this is the first quarter of the year. As the first quarter report of the year, also sets out a series of amendments which we include the appendix to. And that's just really just the completeness to make sure that those are captured. And that's just mainly in relation to the fact that when the report was, when the plan was put together in March, we didn't have a full year-end outturn position for the indicators. So those amendments are primarily in relation to where the outturn figure has come through later on during perhaps May and June, and that's just had an impact on the targets that have been agreed. At 1.3 as well, it's important to point out that obviously whilst the core plan 15-16 and the supporting director plans have been obviously have been superseded by the council plan, and that features later on the agenda. There's a presentation about the new council plan going forward. This the 15-16 corporate plan and director plan still form the basis of the performance management framework in the year, so that's still the framework that we're working to and reporting. Just moving on then to page 19, which is the appendix one. I don't want to get too distracted by format rather than content, but I just thought it would be helpful just to point out that we have redesigned the performance report, and the intention of that is to try and make it more concise and more streamlined, and to enable committee meetings to focus in quickly and just make it a bit more succinct. So just to go through that very, very briefly, obviously this appendix one is the suite of performance indicators that are in the directorate plan. The title of the performance indicator is in the second column. The third column is the year-end targets for this year. And then the next three columns are the April to June, what the target is for that quarter, the actual performance against the target for that quarter, and then the RAG status, red and green. And the red and green status is determined by the tolerances against the target, so how we're performing against the target. And if we're kind of close to the target, then usually the green, the further away we are from that target, then obviously we are annually there. It also includes a direction of travel column, and that is just intended to provide kind of a sense really of where the trend is in terms of performance based on the last reporting period. It shows really whether things are performance is improving, performance is deteriorating, or performance is being sustained. And then in the final column, our objective with this streamlined report really was to try and zoom in mainly on where the performance indicators are amber or red. And this final column is the corrective action for amber and red indicators. But you will see the green indicators, which are where there's some commentary which is in italics. And that's where some additional context has been provided. The intention will be to not always put anything where performance is green, because we can assume then that unless members have any specific questions and want to dig behind that, we'll assume that there's no need to actually provide any detailed commentary on it. But obviously, in some cases, officers have provided some contextual information that will help members in just understanding that indicator a bit more. So that's the report, and as I say, I won't I'll take any questions on the format now, but probably the best thing is to hand over to go through the indicators one by one in detail. I just normally do it with red indicators.
To ask a question on page 29, that appears to be a gap in the top of the person that's been installed, and I kind of mapped it to the appendix 2 on data. So I think the one that's missing is PHCP04, which is the proportion of opiate drug users. The last drug treatment successfully, who do not re-present to treatment within 6 months. I think that one's been not completed. On page 29.
Yeah, no, what's happened there is that is it's DC. Yeah, 04, the referencing is, referencing isn't always sequential, because the 04 may have been a previous indicator that we reported on last year, but hasn't been included in this year's plan for the bulletin. So when that's signed off in March.
Sorry, Mike. You're right, Councillor, it should be there.
Oh, it should be.
It should be there, yeah, and I don't know why it's not there, but it would be correct.
Well, all it says, I apologise it's not there, and I'll certainly adapt the meeting. Because that hasn't been picked up in the meeting sign up process.
Thank you.
Okay.
Chair, it was exactly the same question.
Can I just ask something that Julie has just done before? I always get. The next one is two is a green, which there are people really ask questions about it, But it talks about the children in need, and before we talked about the fact that some of them are now on a child protection plan, do they cease to be a child in need when they're on a child protection plan? And does that in some way maybe have a, I mean, I think you slightly indicated that. The other thing was, is it a child in need is, if I remember, is defined by the Children's Act of whenever it was, 1989. Is it just, I mean, it's not we're alone, is it? It's just our way that we now consider that definition and how it's applied. Am I right in thinking that that view has changed over the years? Or, I mean, what is it? Because you talk here about, and it comes in the appendix as well, that we've reviewed the basis of in line with the current basis for assessing children in need. It sort of gives the impression that the criteria has changed, but it wasn't. Is that not the case, or is it? What gives rise? It says to reflect the percentage decrease to reflect the positive impact of the strategic service. What has the strategic service done? Is really my question to change that mean that we've now moved the target to an even more a lower target than it was before.
I'll try and explain that. I think the definition of the child in need has been fairly constant since the Children Act 1989, and Wirral has a high number of children in need. That means that social workers have got very high caseloads. What we've been doing is reviewing the children in need. I talked earlier about reviewing those children who've had a plan for more than 12 months. And I think when we embarked on that, we thought that some of those children their cases could close and step down into an early help service and stop being within social care. But what we found was there was a significant number where the risk was fairly high, and they needed to step up rather than step down when it had to children in social care. So if you look at the rate of children in need for 10,000, you'll see it's very difficult because it's expressed in the rate per 10,000. But in the explanatory column, we said at the end of June that meant 2,799 children were in need. For the way it's actually expressed in our government terms, children in need, that's all the children that social care in Wirral are working with. So that includes the children in need, we've got a children in need plan. That overall figure incorporates those children in the child protection plan. It incorporates our children who are looked after. But the plan is, and what most local authorities are doing, is they're setting up more robust early help services, and the Troubled Families Programme is an early help service. They're looking at whether those children who formerly would have a social worker, where they could step down into a fairly robust early help service. So the plan over time will be we have a slimmer child in need population, much slimmer, and then we have the children subject to a child protection plan and those looked after.
Well, I think it may be slightly uneasy because the Children's Act is still the Children's Act and the definition of the child in need is still the same as it was before. But the numbers we have have reduced because of other processes that are going on, like the Troubled Families Unit. I mean, is that a fair way of putting it? Because ultimately, at the end of the day, the number of families that we've got that have got issues remain the same, if not greater than they've been for the last 10 years.
I think the definition of children in need has not changed. I think, if I'm being brutally honest, because social workers have been so busy with so